So go watch car commercials. I always do this with my students. Watch any commercial. We'll do this a few times in a class. Pick a commercial. Somebody says jeans. Okay, give me a brand. Somebody says Levi's. Okay, let's look at a Levi's commercial. And let's ask, in that commercial, do they give you any rational reason why their product is preferable to the competitors? Is there any data? Are there any facts? Are there any features that they list? Or are they just showing the character that might be you in a pair of Levi's jeans, driving through a Jeep across a beach with a gang full of friends in the back who are having a great time as they go up the mountains or something? You know, often they associate their product with adventurousness, with beauty sometimes, with happiness, with all these positive things, which is basic classical conditioning.
Have you ever noticed the bittersweet relationship between psychology, business, and marketing? From how running a business affects a person's mindset to the various tools and techniques a marketer uses to influence you. If this is something you find interesting, today's episode is for you. Hi, I'm Nishant Garg with What Market Wants. My guest for today is a professor of psychology. He has been teaching at the University of Toronto for more than 25 years. He's a highly respected keynote speaker. He has given TEDx talks and won many awards for his lecturing and tech innovations. He's the co-founder of an EdTech company. And apart from all this, he's also the lead guitarist and vocalist of a band. Let's welcome Steve Jordans. Hi.
Hey, Nishan. Nice to be with you today. Thank you.
So, Steve, could you walk us through your journey from being a professor to a musician to an entrepreneur?
Okay. It actually sort of happened mostly in that order too. So when I became a professor, I'd done all my background research in what's called cognitive psychology. So studying human memory and attention, those sorts of things, which I loved. I loved that research. But when I got into the classroom, so 1995 is when I started teaching, I realized I loved teaching more, that I really loved that whole interaction with a class. And so slowly over time, my research shifted more towards educational technology and educational psychology. Specifically, I love big classes. We were talking a little before the show. My typical fall class is about 1,600 students and myself. But I want those students to have a really rich, deep experience. And so I've started asking, how could we use technology to create almost a Socratic style interaction among the students? And we went to work, you know, learning about that. And ultimately, we created a lab called the Advanced Learning Technologies Lab. And we've created a few technologies ourselves, including one that's called Peer Scholar, which is our sort of pride and joy. And that's the one that right now is an ed tech that's out in the market. We're sort of We're making revenue, but we're just pre-investment, and so we're at that fun sort of stage where we've been able to bootstrap ourselves to where we are, and we're in a pretty good place. But do we want to sort of add the rocket fuel of investment and try to jump to a higher place? So that's sort of where the EdTech is. On the music side, the story there very quickly, but it's an important part of it, I think, is when I was about late 30s. We had a dog that was not healthy. We used to travel a lot, but we decided we weren't going to travel anymore. We were going to spend a lot of time with our dog during her last few days. And we decided to start picking up guitar as a reason to just kind of hang around the house and do something. And so that was like Twinkle Twinkle Little Star when I was 39. And it's been a slow journey, but it's my therapy. It's what I do now to relax and to have fun.
So by we, you mean you and your wife?
Yeah, we're one of those creepy couples that do almost everything together. She works in the registrar's office at the university where I teach. And yeah, she's in the band with me. We also both ride motorcycles, and that was her idea. So she rides her own motorcycle. She doesn't sit on the back of mine.
Wow, that's lovely. So tell me, what drove you to start your own company, your own business?
Yeah, we created this technology, and because we're researchers, we did a bunch of research on it, published papers, gave talks at conferences. And originally, the idea of that research was just to show the efficacy of what we were doing. This was really working. It was helping students. But then the spin-off of that is other professors heard about it. and of course started to say, hey, can we use that technology in our class? And so Dwayne, my partner in crime on the tech side, he had a server under his desk and he was trying to help 15 other professors do stuff. And it just came to a point where he had to work on his PhD. He didn't have time to be doing all this stuff. And so we literally at that point, it's a long journey, but we started looking for companies that might just want to license, rebuild a commercial version, do all the hard business work, and then we were just going to get nice little royalty checks every now and then. That fantasy did not turn out. the other companies that we worked with, and there were some big, powerful companies, but they just couldn't really deliver the way that we felt it had to be delivered. And so starting 3 years ago, really, we said, okay, we're going to take this, we're going to rebuild it ourselves, we're going to do it all in-house. And so the real serious business push started about 3 years ago. And it started with a bunch of free pilots. So the first year was no revenue, just trying to build awareness, just trying to get people to use it. And then our first real sort of positive revenue year was last year. And now this year is one of those weird things where we say thanks to COVID, which no thanks to COVID generally, but thanks to COVID, EdTech is doing well. People are looking much more at EdTech and what it can do. And ours really targets the what's called the skills gap, trying to build critical thinking, creative thinking, communication skills. And that's something the market suddenly is prioritizing. So it's been a fun time, although it's a very, I'll call it stressful in that exciting way. We're at that point where, you know, things are getting big.
Talking about stress, it's very common for entrepreneurs to stress out due to the financial risk involved in running a business and such uncertain times. So how do you suggest one should deal with it?
Yeah. So it's funny. I mean, I heard you start to mention financials. And one of the funny things with me is I'm good with numbers. I even teach stats courses until you put a dollar sign in front of it. Once you put a dollar sign in front of a number, it becomes emotionally charged to me. You know, this is money that somebody needs for their family or whatnot. And so I get very anxious around the financial side of business. And my way of dealing with it is to stay away from it, which is not necessarily the best way, but I have somebody else whose job it is to really focus on that. But, you know, generally speaking, in terms of anxiety, the core sort of critical thing is that you just don't let it become what we call chronic. You don't allow it to be there all the time. When it's there all the time, you will actually eventually have burnout and kind of crash. And in fact, physically, you'll become susceptible to a lot of health issues if you allow the anxiety to continue. So a real key to anxiety management is finding ways to give yourselves breaks now and then. We mentioned guitar playing. I told you it's my therapy. It's something I do where when I'm doing it, I'm not thinking about anything else. I'm just trying to learn freaking Brown Eyed Girl or some song, trying to get everything right. And so it's something I use to get away from the stress. The motorcycles as well are something I use to get away. Some people might like to meditation or something like that, but I think everybody has to find something that gives them some sort of cognitive peace every now and then. And they need to schedule that as though it were medicine, as though it were something they really needed. Let me mention a couple things. If you can get these things into your life somehow, they're really medicinal. Those things are music, singing, dancing, laughing, aerobic exercise. Any of these things improve our emotional well-being. And so, for example, if you notice, you know, you're just sitting around and you watch some show and it's really making you laugh and you realize something is making me laugh, whatever that thing is, make a mental note of it and say, hey, are there other shows like this? Or is this a series I could watch every week or something like that? Because it's got power for you. If it makes you laugh, it's going to oppose the cortisol that anxiety releases with a bunch of good hormones that actually heal some of that damage. So yeah, those things are especially strong.
Coming to the topic of branding and marketing, psychology has a big role to play in the whole process. Yeah. A huge part of it is understanding people. If you ever talk to a marketer, you may come across terms like consumer behavior, psychographics. This is basically an attempt to understand what's on your consumer's mind. So tell me, how do you find out what does your market really want?
Yeah. I mean, it really, so one example of one of the things we do is we have a customer board, which I really highly recommend to anybody with a small business. It's easier than you think. Once you have a few customers that are happy, they tend to feel very special. If you invite them to be part of a group that's going to help you develop your product. So, you know, that's what you kind of say. You guys are important to us. We'd like to meet with you regularly, talk to you about what we're doing, talk to you about the roadmap, where we're going. And your task is to represent the customer. So you try to get as representative of a group as possible. And you really encourage them to play devil's advocate, to tell you things that you might not have been thinking about, et cetera. So that's, you know, one of the things we use heavily. Of course, you can use a lot of analytics, just what you're gathering. So as far as things like website and UX, you can literally track what's attracting people, what parts of the website are especially powerful. Does it seem like they're looking for something that isn't there? So that can give you a little bit of the mind of the consumer as well. From my perspective, I have the advantage, I guess, where I'm a professor in the higher ed space, and typically my consumers are professors in the higher ed space and the Center of Teaching and Learning, which kind of controls education on a campus. And I know them. I live with these people all the time. And so I have the advantage of sort of being my own market, I guess, which helps a little.
So tell me, does your background in psychology give you an edge in running your business?
Yeah. I wonder. It was interesting to kind of think about that a little bit. It certainly allows, like, for example, just the idea of creating a short video, which often we do a lot of things with short videos now, a minute or less video that's meant to kind of excite people about something. Maybe it's a new feature. Maybe it's the product itself. But we use a lot of psychology sort of aspects. So one of the things we know, for example, is you want to keep making changes, so-called pattern interrupts in things that you deliver. If you just have, say, one talking head person sitting there for 3 or 4 minutes, talking and talking and talking, it's very easy for the person's attention to drift. But if things change on a relatively regular basis, every time something changes, that kind of draws the person back to that thing. And so you might have a 1 minute video, but there could be as many as, you know, 20 or more changes that happen during that video. It may be changing back to a state where it was before, but that feeling of motion kind of gives energy and attracts the eye. And then, of course, it's all about the script of those things. So we do a lot of work with micro learning as well. And those two converge really well. So micro learning is, you know, how can I make a 2 or 3 minute video to instruct somebody, say, how to give feedback, how to give quality feedback, but I want to do it in a way that engages them and where they really can sort of take the information well, where we organize that information in such a structured way that it will really stick in their minds a little bit. And so we certainly think about that a lot when we create our micro learning, and a lot of that same thought process sneaks in when we create our marketing sort of items as well.
So being a professor of psychology, when you're out shopping, do you look at things from a different lens? The reason I'm asking you this is, coming from a marketing background, I can't help but look at things differently. I start noticing things like how a brand is trying to persuade you, their sales process, and so on. So does that happen with you as well?
Becomes a habit of mine when you analyze something that way. You think of it all the way. Yeah, I like to do this with my students, actually. We talk about what in psychology we call persuasion. And there's two routes that people talk about, the central route and the peripheral route. The central route, really think like a TEDx talk. So the idea of the central route is, if you have an audience of people who are open and eager to hear what you have to say, and they're willing to really think deeply about what you have to say, then if you want to persuade them, you want to persuade them with facts and logic and rationality. That's what people are doing in TEDx talks. They're trying to convince the audience of something, and that audience is willingly, deeply listening and thinking along with them. If you want somebody to buy something, you often don't care about that rational thing. You often use instead what we call the peripheral route, which is you take your product and you associate it with stuff you think your customers like. So go watch car commercials. I always do this with my students. Watch any commercial. We'll do this a few times in a class. Pick a commercial. Somebody says jeans. Okay, give me a brand. Somebody says Levi's. Okay, let's look at a Levi's commercial. And let's ask, in that commercial, do they give you any rational reason why their product is preferable to the competitors? Is there any data? Are there any facts? Are there any features that they list? Or are they just showing the character that might be you in a pair of Levi's jeans, driving through a Jeep across a beach with a gang full of friends in the back who are having a great time as they go up the mountains or something? You know, often they associate their product with adventurousness, with beauty sometimes, with happiness, with all these positive things, which is basic classical conditioning, Pavlov. And that makes us like the product. All those positive things get transferred to the product. And so we end up liking this product for no rational reason. Almost every commercial is more emotion focused than rational focused.
So true. Coke is one of the biggest examples of doing that. They're always talking about happiness in their ads. So tell me, how often do you find yourself falling into the impulse buying trap?
So my closest place to connect with this, we've talked about the music a little bit, and in Canada, we have something called Kijiji. I'm sure you must have something there. So it's an online trading place, I guess. Okay. And so people will list guitars. And so I'm addicted to this. I'm continually trading guitars in various ways. And then when I do that, I'm often, you know, watching all the YouTube videos of people showing this guitar ahead of time. And I love the thrill of the chase. I love consuming the marketing, getting hyped about some product. But then what I often do to connect with yours, with your point, is before I go and buy it, I will watch the commercials for the guitar I have already. And what I sometimes find is I fall in love with the guitar I have more than I fell in love with that other product. So I'm at least making it a fair fight. I'm not comparing some familiar thing with this new shiny thing that has the new marketing. I at least look at the marketing for the old thing too. That's one of the ways I attempt. But I have to say, part of me doesn't mind. I'm using the manipulated is such a tricky word, but this is one of the things I get enjoyment, you know, hunting down these guitars, watching their marketing, seeing whatever. It's kind of part of the fun for me, I think.
I can completely relate to you. I share the same love for music and technology, though I don't know how to play any of the musical instruments I own, but I get what you're saying.
I'll trade you some for it. No, I'm just kidding.
So lastly, tell me, what are your favorite psychology books?
Yeah.
Do you have any recommendations for us?
There's a few, depending, like they're kind of all over the place. But if you, one I quite liked was Blink by Malcolm Gladwell. It's Malcolm Gladwell's a reporter. He's not a psychologist, but he talks to all these psychologists. Yeah. And he just writes in a very engaging way. So it's very easy to read. And Blink is about all of the decisions that are made so quickly by the brain and gets into things like micro expressions and stuff that you can see if somebody's unhappy or happy just through this tiny little expression on their face that flashes by in just the blink of an eye, but it really carries a lot of information. So it's a fascinating, it kind of tells us that a lot of our decision making isn't as rational as we think it is. It's in fact much more sort of instinctual, and then we rationalize. We tell ourselves a story for why we did whatever, but really we're reacting at a much lower level. So that's a really cool one. The other one I'll mention really quickly is it's called Moonwalking with Einstein.
Okay.
Yeah, that's an odd thing. It's about memory mnemonics. Can you train your memory? And there are people that do things like, you can look at the International Memory Games. It's like an Olympics, but for people doing feats of memory. And they do crazy things like memorize 5 decks of cards in order that were shuffled all together. They can tell you what every card is. And you say, well, how did they do that? And so this book is by a reporter as well. And he's trying to see, are these people just freaks? Like, do they just have crazy memories? Or did they actually learn how to do this? And I don't want to spoil the ending, but he decides he's going to try to learn to see what happens. And I think that's a really interesting book as well.
Wow. It was a pleasure talking to you, Steve. Thanks a lot for your time and insights.
No problem, Ashant. It's been a pleasure for me as well. Thank you.
If you want to check out his courses on psychology, you will find the links in the description. To get more such great insights from the world of business, branding, and marketing, subscribe, follow What Market Wants on social media, and let me help you unlock your market potential. Take care.